Hi, I'm Dr. Kavita Bapat. Today's topic is postpartum hemorrhage medical management for graduates, undergraduates, and practicing OBGYN. Hashtag learn simply. Is postpartum hemorrhage a legacy or evolutionary past, PPH, an enigma, an unfortunate side effect for the natural selection for the larger brain? When I was reading it, I found out it's really important. The complementary increase in the neonatal brain, it leads to extremely invasive pattern of placenta. And second contributory factor, that is a bipedalism, it resulting into narrow pelvis, more invasiveness of the placenta. And there is a maternal vasculature, which is very important. Now this leads to the incidence of postpartum hemorrhage, irrespective of all the care and everything. It's a 4.1 of all deliveries, and atonic PPH is 3.4%. One of the Millennial Development Goals, MDG 5, in 2000 was to reduce maternal mortality by 75% by 2015, but so far only 45% reduction has been achieved. Causes of maternal death worldwide. It is indirect causes sometimes, which is not under any control. That's a 20%. Other direct causes are 8%. There is a obstructed liver leading to maternal death, 8%. There is eclampsia, 12%. And severe bleeding, which accounts the number one cause of death or the maximum number of deaths due to the severe bleeding. And it accounts 24%. Infection, 15%. And the unsafe abortion is 13%. So the severe bleeding during pregnancy is the number one reason for the maternal death all over the world. Now, how to define PPH is an important topic, and it should be defined nicely. In last 30 years of practice, this definition a little changed, not much, but it's a similar. An estimated blood loss of more than 500 ml after vaginal delivery and more than 1000 ml after cesarean section. A decline of the hematocrit level of 10%. Any amount of blood loss that threatens the women's hemodynamic stability, and the massive PPH refers to the blood loss more than 2000 ml or more than 30% of the blood volume. But these, there are the pitfall in the definitions. They are arbitrary, subjective, and based on the visual examination, underestimate the actual blood loss. Now the classification of PPH, it's a primary PPH and a secondary PPH. Primary PPH, which occurs within 24 hours of the delivery, and secondary PPH occurring after 24 hours of 6 weeks postpartum. Then primary PPH is in 4 to 6% of all deliveries, and it is secondary PPH is 1 to 3% of all deliveries. Now there is an etiology of PPH with four T's. It includes, number one is the tone, that's a uterine atony, 70% full bladder, then tissue, retained tissues and clots, then trauma, uterine, cervical and vaginal laceration, and thrombin coagulopathy, pre-existing or acquired. Now, the etiology of PPH is a primary PPH, may be due to the atony, 80%, retained placental products, membranes and clots, vaginal cervical laceration or hematoma, ruptured uterus, broad ligament hematoma, uterine inversion, and defects in coagulation. Again, in a secondary PPH can be due to subinvolution of the placental site, retained products of conception, especially the placenta, infection, and inherited coagulation defects. These are the risk factors for the PPH during the pregnancy, that is, we call this antenatal. So sometimes there is a past history of hemorrhage, risk 1% to 1 degree, 2nd degree, and 3rd degree pregnancy is 5.8%, 14.8%, and 12.7% respectively. Placental abruption and placenta previa. There can be a multiple pregnancy, 3.3, and macrosomia, 2%. And hypertension in pregnancy, preeclamptic state, eclampsia help, 2.2%. So these are the risk factors of the postpartum hemorrhage antenatally, and we should consider right from hemorrhage, abruption, multiple pregnancy, and hypertension in pregnancy. Now, during antepartum, there are a chances of chorioamnionitis. It is also one of the cause of PPH, polyhydramnios, multiparity, fetal death, anemia. These are the pre-existing antepartum reasons for the postpartum hemorrhage, and sometimes the uterine myoma or the manual removal of placenta also includes into the list. Now, the risk part of the PPH during intrapartum, it's very important because these are the things which can lead to PPH and one should consider it very important. Number one is operative instrumental delivery or assisted vaginal birth, which we can do, or a cesarean delivery also. Internal podalic version or the extraction of the second twin. Third is a prolonged labor. It's one of the important cause. It accounts 7.6% precipitate labor. Induction or augmentation and chorioamnitis, shoulder dystocia, these are also the causes, and acquired coagulopathy is one of the reasons. Now, these are other factors for the PPH postpartum. That's a laceration, retained placenta, placental abnormalities, uterine rupture, inversion, acquired coagulopathy, that is a DIC. But remember, always that PPH is a very unpredictable condition and every parturient woman is at the risk of PPH. So we cannot say that there is no factor, nothing, but still the PPH can be there. It is extremely difficult to make a complex thing simple, whereas it is very easy to make simple things complex. It is a PPH. The passage of time is likely to increase the complexity of any given case because the continuous bleeding not appropriately and adequately controlled on a timely basis invariably leads to coagulopathy. So it's very, very important. If it's not the PPH is not dealt properly, or the third stage of the labor is not dealt properly, so that we can make simple things complex and that can lead to coagulopathy. But now the golden hour, just very, very important time by which the resuscitation must be initiated to ensure better survival, because if medical therapy using 3 or 4 uterotonics has not worked within 1 hour, there is no logical reason to think that they will work next hour. So golden hour is very, very important to make things simple, not to make complicated with the simple things. There is a rule of 30. The patient has probably lost more than 30% blood volume if fall in systolic BP by 30, heart rate rises by 30 beats per minute, respiratory rate rises by 30 per minute, hemoglobin or HCT drops by 30%, and urine output is less than 30 ml per hour. She is in moderate to severe shock. So rule of 30 and golden hour is a very important thing in a management of PPH, and it should be considered well in advance, and it should be kept in the mind while treating the patients. Now, this is a lethal triad. This is called a bloody vicious cycle. That's a hypothermia, acidosis, and third is a coagulopathy. Plays a major role in the morbidity and a mortality of a severe injured or exsanguinating patients. Now, this is the PPH ARMA metrium, compensates of AMTSL, active management of third stage. Uterotonics, delayed clot clamping, controlled cord traction, uterine massage, bimanual compression, balloon tamponade, compression sutures, uterine artery embolization, systemic devascularization, and last and most important again is hysterectomy. Now, management of the PPH. Initial treatment of PPH includes early recognition, followed by prompt attention to the resuscitation and a simultaneous search of the cause of the bleeding. So this is the 3 points, very, very important: early recognition, prompt attention, resuscitation, and simultaneous search for the cause of bleeding. Once PPH has been identified, management involves 4 components, of which undertaken simultaneously. Number one is a communication. Number two is a resuscitation. Number three is the arresting and the bleeding. And number four is monitoring and investigations. There's a joint statement action plan launched in 2004 by ICM and FIGO. It is really good algorithm, has been suggested for the management of PPH. And it is a really good way of doing thing. And it is hemostasis by the alphabet. The H is the ask for help. A is the assess vital bloods and loss, resuscitate. E is establish etiology and check ecobolics, that is endometrine, argometrine, bolus, syntocinon, ensure availability of the blood. M is a massage of the uterus. O is oxytocin infusion, prostaglandins, it can be rectal, intramuscular, intramyometrial, then specific surgical. S A shift to the operating room, exclude retained products and trauma, bimanual compression, anti-shock garment if transfer required. T is a tissue and trauma to be excluded. Proceed to tamponade. Balloon uterine packing. A, apply compression sutures. S is a systemic vascularization, devascularization, uterine, ovarian, quadruple, and internal iliac. I is an interventional radiologist, uterine artery embolization if appropriate. And S is a subtotal or a total abdominal hysterectomy is needed if it's a real, real emergency and to save the patient. Now, CAB of the basic life support should be provided. C is a circulatory blood volume must be restored. A is ensure the airway. And B is the breathing if respiration is not adequate. Involve anesthesiologist and intensivist with you. Now, this is the shock index, heart rate or a systolic BP, normal value 0.5 to 0.7. In significant hemorrhage, it goes to 0.9 to 1.1. Changes in SI, a better correlate identifying acute blood loss. Now, the medical management. That's again O, oxytocin infusion and other ecobolics. Oxytocin should be preferred over all other uterotonics. It's a first line of treatment. If oxytocin alone is not effective, ergometrin or oxytocin-ergometrin fixed dose combination should be offered as a second line treatment. If above second line treatment is not effective, then prostaglandin should be offered as a third line treatment. This is a WHO 2009. Then the uterotonics are oxytocin, methyl ergometrin and sintometrin, and prostaglandin 15-methyl PGF2-alpha and misoprostol PGE1. Now, methyl ergometrin requires specific storage conditions, deteriorates rapidly with the exposure of light, heat, and humidity. Side effects, nausea, vomiting, paresthesias, chest pain, tinnitus, headache, and increased BP. And it is contraindicated in a sepsis, migraine, hypertension, heart disease, vascular diseases, Raynaud's phenomenon, liver and kidney diseases. Now, the sintometrin is a combination of oxytocin 5 units and ergometrin of 0.5 milligram intramuscular. No important clinical difference, effectiveness of the sintometrin and oxytocin for the prevention of PPH associated with the higher risk of hypertension and vomiting. And in a severe PPH, it should not be given. PGF2-alpha, it is administered in doses of 0.25 milligram intramuscular. Contraindication in asthma due to bronchoconstrictive properties of F-class prostaglandins produce nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, pyrexia. Case reports of severe intrapulmonary shunting and hypotension seen. Cardiac, pulmonary, renal, hepatic diseases are contraindication. Misoprostol is a synthetic PGE1 analog, oral, vaginal, rectal, sublingual. And a faster onset of action with the oral and sublingual, rectal and vaginal routes, greater bioavailability, longer duration of action, inexpensive, temperature stability, plasma concentration peaks in 30 minutes, 1 to 2 hours in vaginal, adverse factors, dose dependent, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, chills, shivering and fever. Now the role of tranexamic acid in PPH, again, it offers PPH if uterotonics has failed, stop the bleeding. If bleeding may be partly due to trauma, recommendation strong. WHO now strongly recommend early use of IV tranexamic within the 3 hours of the birth in addition to the standard dose for the women, clinically diagnosis of the PPH following the vaginal birth of the cesarean section. Another studies are based on the regime of the women trial. GDG report the administration of the tranexamic acid fixed dose 1 gram IV at 1 ml per minute, administered over 10 minutes with the second dose of 1 gram IV, the bleeding continues. After 30 minutes, the bleeding restarts within 24 hours of completing the dose. So it is also very, very important. It's a WHO 2017 statement. And there is a consensus view of that fibronectin inhibitors such as tranexamic seldom have a place in the management of obstetric hemorrhage. This is an old thing. Now the medical management, these are the drugs, dose, route, frequency and comment. Oxytocin, 10 to 40 units, 1 liter normal saline at the rate of 125 ml per hour, intramuscular 10 units. Frequency, continuous, avoid undiluted rapid IV infusion which causes hypertension. Methyl ergometrine, intramuscular IV 0.2 milligram, every 2 to 4 hour up to 5 doses in 24 hours, avoid if patient is hypertensive. 15-methyl-PGF2-alpha carboprost or Himebat. This is a 0.25 milligram intramuscular every 15 minute, 8 dose maximum. Avoid in asthmatic patient, relative contraindication. If hepatic, renal, cardiac, diarrhea, fever, tachycardia can occur. Misoprostol dose is 800 to 1000 microgram rectally or sublingually, and it is good, and this is less, complications are less. The blood component therapy, it involves transfusion of 10 PRBC in 24 hours. Ideal ratio RBC and FFP is 1:1 and can be compiled with PRP if the thrombocytopenia in the ratio of 1:1:1. So this is again the chart, right, from packed red cell, platelet, fission plasma and cryoprecipitate. It has got the important role and recommended the transfusion. And there is a role of factor 7, NOVO7 in obstetric COG 10, 2010. If there is a factor 7 is